Joining us now for more analysis on the ISIS threat and their spiritual ambitions is Asar Nomani, author of Standing Alone, An American Woman's Struggle for the Soul of Islam. Nomani describes herself as a Muslim feminist. She's also a contributor at The Daily Beast. Nomani, great to have you on the show. Let me ask you this. You have spent hours studying ISIS videos and their writings. What have you discovered about the group's spiritual ambitions?
Well, I studied these for hours because I wanted to understand exactly what motivated them. And what I learned is that the Islamic State is very much Islamic because it validates its theology based on the Quran, the Hadith, the sayings or traditions of the Prophet Muhammad, the fatwas of scholars through the ages, and finally this last thing called eschatology, or the science of end times, according to Islamic beliefs.
You wrote an article for The Daily Beast asking the question, will it take the end of the world for Obama to recognize ISIS as Islamic? You argue that Obama's tap dance around whether ISIS is Islamic or not is completely wrong. Why do you say that?
I say that because I believe it's really important to know your enemy, just a quote from the Chinese military strategist Sun Tzu. And to really understand the Islamic State, you have to look at the motivation and the theology and the ideology that drives them. What you see in the eschatology that these people believe in is basically their war plan. I understand that there are people of all faiths, from Christians to Jews to Muslims, who believe in end times. But I think that there is a real problem we have in the world when people chase the apocalypse. And my belief is that we, as moderate, rational people in the world, need to avoid a self-fulfilling prophecy of end time and basically call folks out whenever we can when they are chasing the apocalypse. And it might, in this case with the Islamic State, they're very much trying to create a war that will lead to domination as they see it. And we have to really try to understand that if we really want to try to fight them effectively.
What are the consequences for President Obama's lack of decisiveness when it comes to this issue of labeling the enemy, saying that this is a virulent strain within radical Islam, within Islam, that is trying to bring about this apocalyptic, this end times? What are the consequences?
You know, to me, the consequences can be very dire. In 1940, America was faced with a very serious question about whether we were going to call out Nazi Germany for the persecution that they were inflicting upon people in their country. We made a decision to finally take a stand regarding Nazi Germany. And in the same way, I believe that right now in 2015, we are in a position where we have to call out extremist Islam for what it is. You know, I grew up in a moderate Muslim family, and I believe very strongly that we each have a moral duty to stand up against extremism in our faith. And so for that reason, that's why I do what I call my jihad bil qalam, using the Arabic word for pen, a struggle of the pen to try to fight against this extremism. And I believe the Obama administration would really do our country a service if they would speak honestly about the very serious issues that we face.
On the subject of Islamic eschatology, there's a moment in the ISIS video released last month showing the beheading of the 21 Egyptian Christians. There's a moment where the main executioner makes reference to Jesus Christ and the return of the Islamic Mahdi, the Islamic Savior. Can you tell us more about this?
Absolutely. You know, for years now, I've been studying Christian and Islamic eschatology. What I noticed very quickly was that there are real parallels, except, of course, for the end. And the end, as the Islamic State and many people who believe in Islamic eschatology embrace, is this idea that the armies will come down from Khorasan, which is in eastern Iran and northern Afghanistan, waving these black banners. And that's why we see these black banners always in the iconography of folks like the Islamic State. They will come through Syria, and then they will arrive in Damascus. And Jesus, whose name is Isa, then in Arabic, will stand at a minaret at the Grand Mosque of Damascus. And there he will meet the Mahdi, the Messiah of Islamic eschatology. The Mahdi will ask Jesus, please lead the prayer. And in this very important moment in the prophecy, according to those who believe in it in Islam, Jesus will say, no, you lead the prayer. And so what's that code for? That he defers to the leadership of the Mahdi. And so in that way, at that significant moment, we have this important departure from the eschatology of other faiths. I, as a liberal Muslim, do not believe in these prophecies. I do not believe that there is an end times. I believe that ultimately the Antichrist, or the Dajjal, as it's called in Muslim eschatology, is the metaphor for the vices inside of our own heart. I know that might also be a departure from people in Christianity who do believe in end times, but I think the deeper point for all of us is that we should reflect so that we don't create an apocalyptic war in this world. And that is sadly what the Islamic State is trying to do.
Asra, your most recent article for the Daily Beast is entitled ISIS, Christians Worse Than Murderers. Why is ISIS specifically targeting Christians? You make the argument in your article that it is based on the Quran. It is based on the Holy Scriptures as according to their interpretation, right?
Right. You know, I grew up in America. I had as my first boyfriend, a nice boy with Polish Catholic ancestry named Michael. I grew up in a family that completely believed in the peaceful coexistence of all people. But sadly, the Islamic State takes texts from the Quran. I have one Quran right in front of me here. And there's this chapter and verse that comes from the a chapter called Al-Toba, which is sometimes called the war verse. And in chapter 9, verse 5, then, it says, when the sacred months have passed, kill the mushrikun wherever you find them and capture them and besiege them. So the mushrikun is a word for people who are pagan, polytheists, or non-believers. Now, most Christians would say, hey, we're not pagan. But in this interpretation that the Islamic State puts forward, the belief in the Trinity amounts to polytheism. And so I know that may be offensive to a lot of Christian listeners, but nonetheless, the issue that emerges then is that anybody who strays from their idea of, quote, Tawheed, or the oneness of God, is a mushrikun and then liable for a target on their back. And that's included me, because I don't accept their interpretation of Islam. And so I also have been called a mushrikun. The word that they are borrowing from is this word called shirk. And shirk means the belief of any entity equal to God. And that is then what we are all guilty of when we don't believe in their version of Islam.
So, and that's what you're seeing today play out across Syria, across Iraq, and not just Christians, but Muslims who don't subscribe to this worldview, this end times worldview of the Islamic State, right?
Yes. And what I also want to do is clearly identify that this is a theology that exists within Islam, and it has been exported from the government of Saudi Arabia into the world. As a result, the Saudis have targeted Shia Muslims or any minority sect within Islam. They have targeted Muslims like myself who don't agree with their interpretation of Islam. And thus, we don't have churches in Saudi Arabia, because to them, this is shirk. This is the manifestation of paganism or polytheism that they refuse to accept. I would argue that their interpretation is sadly misinformed, and that they are in fact themselves wreaking great havoc in the world. In a recruitment video I mentioned in the Daily Beast article, one of the jihadis says, we are here to avoid fitna, which is, it's an Arabic word meaning conflict. And to them, shirk is the worst fitna. But I argue that they are creating more fitna in the world through their interpretation of Islam, and that they must stopped both theologically and operationally.
Asra, I want to come to my final question at some point, talk about how do we defeat this cancer. But you have described yourself as a liberal Muslim feminist. How do you reconcile your faith with what Muslim fanatics around the globe are doing in the name of your religion?
Well, you know, I believe that we are going through our own inquisition right now in Muslim society. And just as Christians and Jewish people also, people of all faiths have challenged those who want to take the text and the traditions of their faith for violent means, I believe that we can challenge also these texts and interpretations for a progressive, feminist, and tolerant view of Islam within our community. All it takes, from my perspective, is a critical analysis that's based on this concept of ijtihad, which is critical thinking. And I really believe that we can do it just as all the other faiths have done in the world.
Terrific, incredible insight. She's the author, her name is Asra Nomani, author of Standing Alone, An American Woman's Struggle for the Soul of Islam. Pleasure to have you on this broadcast. Thank you so much. And I hope we can call on you in the future, because this is a subject that is not going to go away anytime soon. Asra, thank you so much.
Absolutely. And peace to everyone.
Thank you very much.